Today's guest is an amazing success story here from Full Sail. He is a Hall of Fame inductee from the very first Hall of Fame that Full Sail had. He's also won 2 Grammy Awards and obviously multiple platinum engineers. So let's all please give a nice welcome to Phil Tan.
Hello, everyone. Thanks for being here. How should we start?
Here we go. Well, Phil, why don't you just tell them again a little bit of how you started off in the industry as well. So when you graduated Full Sail or left Full Sail, what steps did you take to get involved in the industry full time?
Okay, I came to Full Sail in 1989, so it's been a while. It was a short program at the time. It took 8 months long. In the summer of 1990, I went to Atlanta to do an internship at Soundscape Studios. The reason I went to Atlanta was because all the studios I wanted to intern at, which were in New York and LA, and none of them would take my calls. So Soundscape Studios is where I met a lot of people that I still work with today. Jermaine Dupri, Dallas Austin, Outkast, Organized Noise, L.A. Reid, Babyface, TLC, et cetera, et cetera. So that studio eventually got sold to Bobby Brown and is now owned by Big Boy from Outkast. It's now called Stankonia. But that was one of those serendipitous things where, you know, right place, right time. Atlanta was, LaFace Records has just opened its doors. So we, you know, all the people I mentioned, we all kind of grew up together in that scene. So that's where I started.
And when you started out, again, just to clarify, because you mainly are a mix engineer now, but yes, you did start out kind of doing a little bit of everything, right?
Yes. Initially you didn't get a lot of choice in what it is that you did. But so you just did whatever was necessary to keep the sessions going, help everybody involved. It's a lot different time than it is now, where a lot of work is being done in front of a computer screen. Back then, there were no computers in recording. Mostly it was tape-based, analog gear, so you had to be in the studio with musicians, producers, songwriters, just quite different. In 1992, Jermaine had a huge record with Kriss Kross and was offered a deal by Columbia Records to start So Def Recordings. Jermaine is a little bit different of a producer than most. A lot of producers hire people who are available. I got to record a song today. Let's call around, see which engineers are available. He wasn't quite like that. He and I got along great when we met doing a TLC session. So when So Def Recording started, he said, "Would you come and be like essentially the staff engineer?" Although I was never officially an employee. And our typical day would be me starting at the studio around 11 mixing. He would do whatever record labels people do at the office, and he'd get done around 7, come to the studio, we'd listen, tweak the mix. Once he was happy, he would leave to go home and start writing. I would finish up the mix, print, all that type of stuff, and then join him at his home studio to record all night. So that went on for about 5 years. So around that time, 98 or so, I got kind of burnt out, long hours. We played hard too, but it was kind of, you know, kind of gets a little taxing on your system after a while. So I just stopped and concentrated on mixing.
Awesome. Maybe if you could share a little bit of your current workflow, like what are you doing currently in the studio? Maybe some projects that you find piquing your interest right now that you're working on?
Well, the way I work these days is a little bit different than how it used to be. I usually have multiple projects at different stages. So right now, I can't remember everything, just off the top of my head, but there's probably about a dozen projects going on all at the same time. So there's not everyone, there's probably two album projects. The rest are all singles and tracks, maybe a song here, two songs there.
And you're saying you're working with some international artists too, I believe, right?
So. Yeah, from Japan, Australia, UK, Denmark. It's a lot more global these days.
The world is a smaller place these days, right?
That's true.
Yeah, it really is.
We all connect easier now because of the internet and technology, so.
Do you find, are you using, in terms of technology, is Dropbox an important aspect of what you do, or is there some other way that you're receiving sessions back and forth, or?
I get sessions all kinds of different ways. We have a server at the studio. Clients can upload stuff and retrieve stuff from the server. We'll use Dropbox, that's fine too. As long as it's secure, we can use whatever.
Awesome. Yeah, any questions out here in the audience? Anybody would like to ask or?
Over
here, I'll get this one.
Just a quick note, I brought a session with me. If you guys want to look at it, that's fine too. I might use it as an example. It's Rihanna's Diamonds. Yes, sorry.
All right, my name is Justin Black. I had a couple questions. One was, how is it working with Jermaine Dupri over the years?
Jermaine, you know, he's kind of like my brother. So he's probably the most important person in terms of me having a career in the music industry. Without him and the people he introduced me to, the records we worked with, you know, worked on, I should say, none of this would be possible. Okay. So,
did you have any input on his beats? Anything he produced, like besides just the mixing?
I mean, you know, I'm not one to be shy about my opinions, but yeah. he can take. But I'm also not somebody that's you know, my way or the highway kind of thing. We're all different, and that's. So if he chooses to accept my suggestions, great. If he doesn't, my feelings aren't hurt either.
Cool. I have one more. You said you do stuff with artists out of the country. Mm-hmm. And I was wondering how you get those type of opportunities.
Combination. A lot of what I do and how people reach me is basically by word of mouth. So a lot of it is, for example, this song here was fortunately quite successful. So I think, I could be wrong, but I think it was number one in about 19 countries. So the countries that, why is that funny? So the people that heard this might have said, hey, you know what, we kind of like the way this sounds, maybe we get that guy to work on our record. So that's how it is. And some people just write me from Facebook or my website. And I try to answer everybody as much as I can, but it doesn't always happen. Thank you.
Take this one right here. This guy. He's waving.
What's up, Phil Tan?
Hello.
Everybody call me Hawaii. I just want to say aloha, bro. All
right.
Aloha. Yo, I know you did this song, Diamonds. I mean, first of all, shout out to Jermaine Dupri. I know he paid $3 million back to IRS, you know what I'm saying? He's back on his game.
I didn't even know that, so thank you.
Yo, I was wondering if you can give us a quick, you know what I mean, something quick, explain how you did the tracks on Diamonds. You know, something simple, like just skim through your tracks.
Sure. The reason I brought this was because I wanted to show you how simple things uncomplicated things really can be sometimes. It really all starts with your ingredients, so to speak. if you have well recorded tracks, then there's really not a whole lot of work that you need to, not a lot of surgery that you would need to perform. So let's take a look here. So here's the makeup of the song. Kick drum. Second kick drum. It's really, it's more like a tom. And like a kind of a low subby one. And another low subby one. So let's see. See, that's a clap, and there's an echo that goes with it. That's the sound. Where is it? Yeah, so that's a little echo. Snare. Clap. That's a clap sound. Put a little reverb on there. Another, let's see, where is it? Another kind of snappy type of clap. And that's with the reverb. It's another one. Wait, hang on. So there you have that. And then towards the end of the song, this one here has an EQ on it, just to boost a little bit of the, get like, the high end crack to it. Something called a bossy clap. With the reverb. Again, just a little bit at the top end to bring that out. Towards the end of the song, and then this. So those are the drums. So nothing terribly complicated, as you can see. I mean, with the kicks, I didn't EQ or compress any of it because the sounds were good. At least I thought so. So with the rest of the music, let's take a look. This is a ride cymbal. Hi-hat. Tambourine. Same thing, a little bit of reverb here. Wash it out a little bit. More tambourines. And more tambourines. Now we get to cymbals. Here's the bass. Another bass. Although it's featuring more of a higher frequency. It's basically playing that bass pattern. That this here is the Air Design. I think it comes with Pro Tools, the lo-fi plugin. Not really overdoing it, just to give it a little bit more character. Sub. And then another synth. This is the Massive from Native Instruments. So we have an arpeggiator. So that's the original sound. This with the compressor. And we have a filter freak that's doing a distortion. Okay, so this is the main synth. This is the compressor. So it's a little bit too bright. That's why the lo-fi is there to kind of tame that a little bit down. Echo Boy. Well, it's a synth. This is going to be pretty subtle. Just just to add a little fatness to it. Another massive synth. And then in the bridge, we have a filter here. That's all it does in the song. Another sound, here's the piano. Here's the main piano. Now we got an organ. Okay, this here starts off with the... This actually isn't doing anything other than adding a little bit of character to the sound itself. So, just a little bit warmer with that compressor. And then a distortion plugin. Trumpet. So we got that. It's a spring reverb. So this here, it's doing that. You can see the automation. And then delay. Just to spread it out a little bit. Here's a flute. A bit of reverb and something called a frequency shifter. It's kind of an interesting little plugin. Hang on, let's see. If you haven't used it, you can try to screw things up pretty decent here. Different modes. Oh, it's in bypass. Of course, right? So, I guess the thing is, a lot of times you really won't know what you're getting until you experiment. So, whatever you have, sometimes you can find an unexpected use for a plugin that you don't even really look at all the time. Let's see, what else do we have? We have a xylophone. That's without the reverb. It's another one. And then a little bit of extra noise at the bottom. This isn't very loud, but that's what it is. It's just there to add a little texture. Okay, that dry sounds like this. So a little bit of spring reverb and an echo boy. This. Like a voice sample. Nothing too crazy. Low end is filtered out. Compressor and then a reverb to just kind of make it distant. Laser. Bit of strings. A little bit of the detail at the top end. And a compressor. Not doing a whole lot, just to kind of keep it in check. Violins. Cello. So that's pretty much the makeup of the song. And then the vocals, there's not very many vocals at all. So that's that. the rest of it is just, well, vocals, there's a tuner on there, but it's really not, it's really at a, just at a, like a stock setting. For better or worse, it's become part of her vocal sound. But it's not really doing.
File. Right away. At first sight.
So without
right
it.
Right away. At first sight, I felt it.
Not that much of a difference, but it's there. Channel EQ filtered out from 80 below. Little boost at 9K or so. Little boost here at about 6, 5.5, so forth, a little compression. And then another compressor that follows after that.
Right away.
About 3 dB there, so.
At first sight, I felt.
All the vocals are pretty much treated the same way. She recorded it, from what I understand, the same time. It wasn't one of those sessions where she was recorded over a long period of time or anything like that. Then here the effects returns for the vocal. Plate, reverb, delay, a flanger, a doubler, and another doubler type thing, just to fatten up her vocal a little bit. Bypassed. Let's just go ahead and bypass all these real quick.
Right away.
That's her vocal.
At first sight, I felt the energy of some rage. I saw the life inside.
So that is the whole song, pretty much. So. Was that enough? Okay.
So Phil, when you start your mix, we talked about this a little bit the last thing, but like for this type of session, when you actually start this mix, what's the first thing you approach on a mix like this?
I don't actually remember. Because yeah. I work on about 200 songs every year, so trying to make me recall, I mean, think of like
just
something.
One like this, like like when you get a... Mm-hmm. A session this size, 90 some tracks.
This is small.
Right. But you can get one this size, and it's this type of music. Where do you start? Like when you first open up the tracks and you see them on the computer, kind of what do you have a workflow that you go for when you're?
I don't, sadly. I'm one of those people who I'm a little bit ADD. Like I'm not really structured really well. So a lot of times what I do is I just hit play, and whatever gets my attention, I go right to it.
Right.
That's kind of how I work a lot of times.
Awesome.
So.
We have a question right here in the middle. Yeah. Let's hit that one.
My question is, how much do you mix in the box, and do you use any outboard gear on mixes like this?
I do, actually. I couldn't bring all the outboard gear with me, so. I routed everything internally for this mix to be able to show you. But yes, there were some. I used a summing box, for example. I have on this here. I did this just to kind of show for this particular session, for this particular presentation. But in actuality, there was an outboard EQ that I used for the stereo bus. So, but yes, I do use some outboard stuff. Is that me making a noise? Yeah, sorry. I can't.
Xavier.
Hi, Xavier.
I just had a question with multiple instruments that take up the same frequency range, how do you go about balancing that and like cutting and boosting the right frequencies to get the sound that you're looking for?
I think you have to establish what that particular instrument's job is in the song. So then, and a lot of times the answer might not be immediately obvious, and it might be a process where in the beginning, you thought it was supposed to do this, but by the end of the song, you go, oh, no, it's not. It's supposed to do something else completely. So, again, it's not a... I'm not a set it and leave it kind of guy. It just continually morphs toward the day. And it also depends on the day that I'm working. This, if I got this now today versus 6 months ago, I might do it completely differently. So.
Hello, Phil. My name is Gerald Douglas.
You got a sexy voice going.
Thank you, thank you. My question basically is, at what point do you think your mix is finished? Because as I've come along through Full Sails and I listen back to my old mixes, I can see that I was, I don't know, on crack or something, because they just don't sound good. And then I hear noises and things that I never heard before. So I'm asking...
Your ears are getting better.
Yeah, exactly. So from your experience, where you're at now, at what point after you know, spent however many hours you spent on this song, when did you think, okay, this is good enough to send off and it's good to go?
Well, it doesn't, for me, it's never finished until the client tells me it's finished. That's how I look at it. So when I got this to a point, actually in this case, this was the mix that they approved. So once I got to this point, I sent it out, and again, it's not as simple as it used to be. You have producers. In this case, it was Stargate and Benny Blanco. So Stargate, there's two guys. So they had to okay it, Benny had to okay it, Rihanna has to okay it, the record label has to okay it, her management might have something to say. You never know. In some cases, there might be parents involved, and mom says, oh, vocal's not loud enough. And so you got to deal with all that. So once everybody tells you we're good to go, then I'm done.
And how often do you get mixes sent back to you, as in they weren't finished?
All the time. It's just, you never know. Because, see, a lot of times what happens is that as a mixer, I'm not actually involved with the recording process that often. So a lot of times when I'm listening to this, thank you. Should I? A lot of times, I'm hearing the song for the first time. So I may not be listening to things the same way that they've been listening to. So certain things that might be, like say for example, and I don't know this for a fact, but I'm just taking a guess with this example. Let's just say this little sound here. Was super important for some reason that they added it at the very end. And I didn't have it turned up loud enough. Someone might say, hey, that really needs to, you gotta be able to hear that. Then we'll have to turn it up. But you never know necessarily who is gonna key in on what part of the song. Certain people, and same thing, even with her vocals, she might say, you know what, I need my more reverb, more echo than maybe I like. But it's her record, so you want to make sure that she's, you know, ultimately happy with it. It's hard, I don't know that there's ever a... I don't know, I just know when I think it's ready for them to listen to. So it could be a couple hours, it could be days. Just never know.
All right, thank you.
So, sorry, not trying to avoid your question, but that's
the
truth.
Perfect. That was perfect.
So. Awesome. Hi, Phil. Right here.
Hi.
Yeah. First, I have two questions, actually.
Okay.
With this mix here, right, you said that you dumbed it down a little bit for the presentation?
Not that much. This is actually the mix. The only difference is that there's stuff, the outboard stuff that I didn't bring with me.
Pre-process.
And then the master bus is probably different because I use an external EQ for it. But honestly, the only thing I did was to try to roll out some of the super low frequencies. So. CPU overload. Oh no. So, but anyway. I'm alive. We're like diamonds in the sky. I knew that we would come. Okay, with the low end not filtered out, it almost seems like it slowed down the song. And I didn't want that. So that's why I have it there. So the EQ that I have. That's the nature of analog gear, is that a lot of times they have a certain pleasing quality about them. For whatever reason, the distortion that they introduce to them is musical. So that EQ gave it a little nice, kind of like a top end, like shine to it, without even having anything boosted. So that's why I use it. So this is what I use as a substitute for this. So yeah, there's really not that much dumbing down, as you say.
Okay. And next, with the Nexus piano, did that come sounding great already, or did you do some processing with that as well?
Nexus piano, let's see.
I know it says Nexus 2 or something like that, or high piano or low piano or something like that.
Is it a blue track right there?
Yeah. Just pass it.
I think it's a blue track right there, Paul.
This one here?
I think so.
It's electric piano?
Yeah.
Compressor.
Yes.
And another compressor. So the only reason for the compressors is because you just want to keep it from a volume standpoint consistent. That's it. The sound was fine. It's doing what it's supposed to do.
Okay. And
at least to me anyway. So.
Nice. And my final question, second question. Do you mix stereo and then go into mono, or you mix only in stereo?
Yeah, only in stereo for me. I don't mix in mono at all, actually. I know you're supposed to check and all that, but...
Cool.
But,
all right.
You know, again, when it comes to monitoring, the room that you're in has a lot to do with how things sound. So if you're used to your room and you know how what is going to sound good in that space, then that's really the key. So.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Phil, real quick, when you get sessions, what do you find to be most consistently wrong with the sessions you receive to mix? Is there anything you can identify that I always seem to have to fix this, or I always seem to have to look for this in a session?
Poor recording really is the biggest issue that I come in contact with most of the time. A lot of people had this fix it in a mix mentality, which I find to be a little bit unhealthy. I told the previous group, it's kind of like food. If you give a chef fresh ingredients, chances are your dish is going to come out better. So if you give him a couple of day-old stuff, it's not going to taste that good. It's kind of the same thing with recording as well. If you get a good sound, again, you don't have to do that much to it to make it sound good. Once you start adding a lot of plugins, EQs, all that kind of stuff, you introduce distortion, phase shifting, all this other stuff that is going to contribute like negatively to the sound itself. So if you focus on a good recording, and then ultimately it'll be fine. So fortunately, the guys I work with here, the Stargate and Benny, those guys, they're professionals. So stuff comes already well done. So you don't have to worry too much about the technical deficiencies, so to speak, and get right to work.
Awesome. Is there another question? I see one in the back there, all the way, right in the far back. Back row back there, I see one. You can start over there, too.
Where are we at? Oh, he's going to get you.
Let me get that guy.
So my name is Krishna, and I have come from India to study here. I have just one question, which is not exactly technical, but I believe that every success has its own struggle path and very tough path. What is your advice to keep up with that path to achieve the success? It's like the place you are here right now.
Well, first of all, I don't consider myself successful. It's kind of hard to say this, but in the earlier days when I was younger, I tend to focus a lot on the results. This is where I want to be. This is how I want to do this. This is how I want things to sound. It's all results oriented. Now, I try to focus a lot less on that, and much more so on the process. The results, if the process is enjoyable, the end result will be fine, whatever it is. And a lot of times, if you stick to if you're unwavering with what it is that you're trying to do, you may not be open to certain things that happen along the way. One example, I wanted to be in LA or New York. That's where the big boys are. That's what I wanted to do. I had no intention whatsoever of staying in Atlanta. So, of course, 23 years later, I'm still there. You know what I mean? But I tried to... but when I was able to basically see what was happening, I allowed a change in my plans. So in your creative endeavors, you got to be able to be flexible to some degree. There's a saying that the strong survive, and I don't believe that that's true. I think the most adaptable people survive. So.
Awesome. Here, I'll get this one.
How you doing? I'm Javon from Atlanta,
good.
Georgia.
Thank you.
My first question is, I know you started off in Atlanta in the 90s, and times have changed a lot. What would you say is not the biggest thing that changed, but do you think times changed for the better or for the worse?
I think it's changing for the better in terms of creativity. I think it's changed for the worse in terms of work ethic. It's changed for the better in terms of creativity because technology is now inexpensive. So, and you can record, you know, back in the day, we used to have to go to a studio to be able to get things done. Now you can do anything, anywhere. You just have to have the creativity to go with your ideas. And just to be able to, in your laptop, you have probably 10 times as much power as we did when I first started out. I don't know. Now, the work ethic angle is a little bit weird, because a lot of people I meet these days tend to... I don't know if this is the right way to say it, but there's a certain sense of like entitlement to it. It almost feels like I got a college degree, so I'm owed something. It's not that way. You got to earn it. So if you, I think part of it too is maybe news travels quicker these days. So a lot of times when somebody has a bit of a success story, you hear about it immediately. And then sometimes, again, if you're a little bit unsure about yourself, you kind of go, well, heck, happened for them, why can't it happen for me? My approach has never been to be comparative. I do listen to other people's work because it's healthy to have a little bit of competition. Like, my friend just did this awesome mix. Now I got to step up. That kind of stuff. So you push each other a little bit. But I still think that there's space for all of us. And you just have to be able to do the right things the right way, and you'll ultimately be okay.
All right, and my last question. Upon graduation, I plan on moving back to Atlanta. And I know you worked at Patchworks before, but what would be...
Actually, I haven't, but I know the place, but I haven't worked in there.
I apologize, my research is a little bit off. But what are like three studios that you might recommend because you had good experiences there.
What is it that you would like to do?
I plan on starting off as an engineer assistant or an intern, and I like every part of the studio, so I eventually want to be a producer, but I don't mind working my way to get to that position.
Okay. Okay, this is going to be a long answer to your simple question, but if you really want to be a producer, that's really in your heart of hearts, that's what you want to be, you should start being a producer right now. Forget the engineering angle. It's good to know the engineering part of things so you can, when you're talking to your engineers, mm-hmm. or if you're engineering yourself, then you're familiar with everything. But the reason I say that is because when I went to Atlanta, I visited several other studios as well. One of them was Crawford, and they were primarily focused on posts. And the reason I went to them was because I thought, you know what, music, this is kind of crazy. Your hours are crazy. Money's not as good. Maybe that 9-to-6 kind of life might be better for me. This was early. I didn't know. And Steve Davis, who was the manager that I interviewed with, he said, Phil, seriously, what do you really like to do? And I said, music. And he said, then you just do music. Forget about all this other stuff. Follow what is most important to you, and I think you'll be okay.
All right, thank you.
So.
Okay, we'll take one over here.
Hi, my name is Brandon Evans. I'm in the Entertainment Business Master's Program. So on the business side, I know everyone is talking about technical stuff, but in regards to how do you determine your rate for mixing? So you get a client and the client comes in, you put it in and say, okay, well, it's gonna be X amount of dollars, and is that based upon how much work is gonna take hours-wise, or you decide on the back end, or is that up front?
Everything is individually negotiated. I have a representative or a manager, however you wanna call that, that does that on my behalf. So me, I wanna work with everybody. So I'm not a good guy to talk business with. So that's why I have him basically do that on my behalf. So I'm actually not involved with any of the discussions as far as budget. So a lot of times, the stuff I do, I have no idea how much I'm getting paid. I know that sounds bad, but that's how I prefer to work, because I don't want mentally to think going into a session, I'm not getting paid that much for this, so I'm not gonna put in as much effort. I treat everything as respectfully as I can that comes through my doors. So at the end of the year, you know, the wife is happy and the accountants are happy, I'm okay. So bad, you know, management advice for you, but that's how I approach it.
And having people you can trust is important in the industry.
Yes, that's
too.
True too. Yeah. Yeah. Make sure you treat, again, this is not just for business people, but your support system is going to be very important. Because if you want to do this for real, you have chosen a really crazy business. So the people that are important to you, make sure you treat them well. And I know it's tough because by nature, what we do is really, really time consuming.
So there's a question over there.
How are you, Mr. Tan? First of all, it's an honor to meet you, man.
Oh, thank you.
Wow. But
privilege is mine.
Definitely. But I remember you were saying that when you first started, it wasn't digital at all. So how was the transformation from analog to digital?
A bit difficult, but it was necessary simply because recalls were getting crazy. I mean, on analog gear, probably takes 20 to 30 minutes to do a recall, depending on how big the mix is. So being able to recall things quickly was really the key. And the other part of it is that your clients are a lot of times really super disorganized. So again, I'm not trying to bite the hand that feeds me, but they they don't function like normal people in terms of like the organizational process. It's just random. So it was, let's see, the last full album I mixed on a console was the Clips album with Pharrell. So, but after that, and that album just about killed us because they were so crazy disorganized. They don't work in the normal sense that, okay, here's your writing process, here's your recording process, and here's your mixing process. It all happens whenever it happens. So you might get a session and you go, this is not finished. And they're like, yeah, but go ahead and mix it. And you go, why? And they say, well, because your mix is going to trigger additional ideas for us. So, and then it depends on who started the song in the case of the Neptunes. So if Pharrell starts the song, he might get the song to a point, send it to me, I mix it, then Chad hears it. And then he's gonna go his stuff and he'll send me all his stuff and I mix it and send it back to both of them. Send it back to both of them. And then in some cases it's great. Whatever they both see eye to eye. In some cases Pharrell's like, yo, what's all this new shit? I don't like any of it. Take it all out. And then Chad will go, why'd you take all my stuff out? And then you have to go, hey, why don't y'all talk amongst yourself and then come back to me when you've decided what it is that I'm supposed to be working on. So it's like that. Again, great people, but it's not, if you have to, and again, let me see, one example. Okay, Drop It Like It's Hot. That mix started in my guest bedroom. Okay, it started in my guest bedroom. It went to Chad at the record plant. No, it went to Chad at in his house in Virginia. Then we all convened in the record plant in LA and ended up finishing back in Atlanta. So, you know, the mix, while as simple as can be, probably took a good week and a half just because of all the different things that went on. But see, again, initially all the... Let me think, for example. Okay, the keyboard part that... Da, 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 that wasn't in the song at first. But it's crucial to the song. Now that it's there, you can't imagine it without it. So if Chad wasn't involved, then we wouldn't have had that part and it would have been a completely different record just because of a little tiny part. So you never know where creativity is going to take you. And that's kind of why I had to adapt. So... I try to provide a service basically so as efficiently as I can. That's why I have to change the way I work probably a couple of times already, at least throughout my career. So.
And Phil, you kind of implied earlier too that it was because of the number of clients that you're working with that the recall is very important to that aspect because you can get to it quicker, right?
Yes, yeah. Absolutely. So sometimes you don't work with, I saw like a stat or a graphic one time. There was this one Beyonce song that had 6 producers and 4 writers. So back in the day, it was like 1 writer and 1 producer. So and a lot of times these writers and producers don't live in the same city. Right. And sometimes a lot of the songwriters and the artists are touring. So if, let's say, B is in Australia touring, and I have a writer in London, and I have a writer in LA, they're all on different time zones. So I'm not gonna get my comments back at the same time. It's gonna come whenever it comes. So depending on important I think some of these suggestions might be, I might incorporate them right away so the rest can hear it, or I might wait. So just recall is pretty important.
Yeah, absolutely. So, got another question back here.
Hi, Phil. My name's Dylan.
Hi, Dylan.
Thank you for coming, first of all.
Absolutely.
And my question is, when you're going about building the image of your mix, what is your ultimate goal, and how does it differ when you have real instruments or a song with more electronic elements?
The ultimate goal is really pretty simple for most of the work I do, and that is to get on radio. So I try to approach it that way. Unless someone tells me, you know, don't worry about radio, just do whatever you want. But ultimately, that's kind of where, for some reason, I found myself, is the radio. So I think one of the things you're going to have to learn as a mixer is how to be receptive of what the music wants to be versus what you want it to be. So a lot of times, just, you know, when you hear something, let it tell you what needs to be done. So I hope that makes sense.
Get one more over here, and then we'll go back to the other side.
Hi, my name is Dexter Randall.
Hi.
Nice to meet you. Thanks for coming out.
Thank you.
A lot of time in the classes here, we're taught to mix to certain levels, like negative six is always a number for pre-master. And I find myself becoming timid within my mixes for necessarily pushing them. How much are you able to, in your own workflow, push the mix beyond what conventional people would say?
I think that kind of depends on, it depends on the material that you're working with. Obviously, if you're working with a jazz trio, you don't want a limiter to just be slammed and you have a big block of audio. So in dance music, limiting is going to be, that's kind of part of the sound. So the key is actually to find the right limiter to get you the best results, because again, they all function differently. As far as levels, I'm bad about that kind of stuff. I don't pay that much attention to it. Usually, I try to make sure that the music has its dynamics. So, and it's not just like this one solid square chunk, basically, that sometimes you see people do. I'll let the mastering engineers do that if it's necessary. But my master typically just stays at zero or thereabouts. It doesn't really fluctuate that much. So when, and I don't know if this makes sense to a lot of people just yet, but when I'm mixing, I mix at a specific listening level. It almost never fluctuates. I don't listen really loud. You and I can have a conversation, and it just kind of stays that same volume pretty much the entire time I mix. And the reason for that, it's helpful to me because I know if I'm going too loud with something. So if I'm pushing something too hard and I start to hear maybe things start to clip or distort, or, you know, it's just one of those things where I kind of know what my room sounds like at that particular level. And when I overdo something, it kind of tells me to dial back. But it's not to say that you can't try to push boundaries. Okay, the reason why a lot of music happens is because people make happy accidents. It's like back in the day in the 80s when rap music was in its infancy, most of the engineers didn't like working with rap because it was, quote, wrong, like technically speaking. But it sounded good. Then that's what they did, was they did things wrong, but it sounded right. So go with what you think is right. Yes, the teachers are gonna try to tell you, and it's not a bad thing to be mindful of levels and try to keep things under control, but you might do something that's gonna benefit the rest of us by doing something wrong later on. So.
Is there another one over here that we saw? Yeah, right here in the corner.
Hello, fellow full sellers. Phil Tan.
Yes, sir.
John?
What's up, buddy? Phil, you mentioned early in the presentation that you don't consider yourself successful. So I guess my question would be, and I'm interpreting that, you know, you are, or maybe you haven't achieved something, you know, so what is it that's missing that where you would consider, okay, yes, I'm successful now. So, yeah.
I don't think there's anything missing. What it is is more of a defense mechanism for myself. Okay, this whole business, one of the reasons why I think I've been able to work this long on this particular career is that I try to be honest. I don't, when something isn't, so much of this business is built on hype, and it's unfortunate. So a lot of people, and you know, you're getting hammered all the time, people from Twitter or Facebook or whatever telling you, oh, listen to my stuff, it's great. And then you listen to it and it's crap. And you go, look, you just wasted my time. You know what I mean? So now, anytime I get something from you, I know it's crap. So I'm not gonna listen to it. So you, as a creator, have to be honest with yourself. Like, is my stuff really that good? Is it gonna compete with the rest of the stuff that is in fact good? You have to be honest with yourself, and that's what I try to be. So when you say something that's successful, when you touch about that subject, I look around and I see so many other people that have done so much more than me, and not necessarily in terms of, you know, I just make music, man. I don't save lives. I don't really do anything in the grand scheme of things that important. I do this because I've been fortunate. I didn't want a job, you know what I mean? Like, I didn't want to feel like I go somewhere, oh, guys, I got to do this. It's just, this is why I chose to do this. So, but at the same time, it's also because I'm not afraid to reinvent myself. So if technology changes and there's something new that comes about or something happens, so let's say one of my clients comes to me and says, Phil, man, your system is not working anymore. You have to step up. And I would be able to say, I wouldn't have any problems with that. I'd be like, all right, let's analyze the situation and see what we can do better. So it's not the time that you spend here in Full Sail is, and you know, I know you're learning about Logic and Pro Tools and all these different programs and equipment, all this kind of stuff. But the key to me for you is to get in the habit of learning, just period. It's not, because once you get in the world, by the time you get out, some of the stuff that you learn here might be obsolete. How adaptable you are once you're in the marketplace is going to determine how well you survive. So.
Bill, is there anybody, like, when you were starting to get into mixing in the industry, is there any person who is already involved in mixing that you kind of said, I've really got to emulate that, or I've got to be that good, or who are some of your idols, in other words?
I see. Bob Clearmount was somebody I listened to a lot back in the 80s. All his work. Mike Shipley was another guy that I listened to a lot. But I didn't know how to emulate them because I just never knew how what they did was really possible. Okay, now there's certain people I look at and they just kind of go, they're really not, I'm not anywhere near being in the league as they are. Because I'm here, they're there. It's just no other way to look at it. But so what I try to do is, with what I have, is maximize what I can and hopefully make the best decisions I can with what I have.
So. Awesome, awesome. Any questions?
Right here.
Thank you. Well, apparently I need to go up here and give this lady a chance. Here you are.
Hello, my name is Jaslyn.
Hello.
In the introduction, they said that you were working with someone helping develop her career for the future.
Yes.
So what exactly services are you providing her, and what advice would you give to all of the up-and-coming artists that are out here?
you have to understand as an artist that you have to be a leader. That's the only way that you're gonna be successful is if you are a leader. You're not following anybody, you're not doing things like other people, you're doing it yourself. The other thing to remember is that we're now at a time where you no longer need what used to be conventionally an artist needs, which is basically a support structure like a record label. You can do everything yourself. The only people that matter to you as an artist is your audience. That's the most important thing. You have them, access to them directly via Twitter or Facebook or whatever, but you have to be genuine about that. They're gonna let you know if what you do is good or bad. So, and they become, that's your audience. You're responsible to them, not anybody else, none of the haters, all that kind of stuff. They don't matter. They don't like you, they don't like you. But if you can earn your audience and maintain that relationship, you'll have them for life. So as far as the development part of it is, I don't look at it as a service per se. I just want this particular girl, she is 16 years old. But what I'm trying to find out actually is whether or not she's gonna be able to do this for the long haul. And by that, I mean, a lot of people change when things, when they find out how difficult this whole process is gonna be. It's a lot of work. Your schedule is packed all the time, whether it's recording, marketing meetings, or you know, you have sponsors that you have to go shake hands, kiss babies, all this kind of stuff. You may have to do TV appearances, movies sometimes. Again, these are great problems to have, but you're not gonna have a lot of yourself. You're giving away a lot all the time. Is she someone that's gonna be able to manage that? So what we're trying to do is basically prepare her for those types of situations. She's gonna take acting classes, she's gonna take songwriting classes, she's gonna learn how to play an instrument. She can sing like a bird already, but she's still gotta maintain. So we're gonna continue her singing lessons and just kind of basically teach her all the things that she needs to know to be able to, you know, once she goes out there, she's not gonna be like, oh gosh, I'm not prepared for this. So managing success and failure is equally important in life. So, because a lot of times what happens is that we all dream big, right? We want the stars. And then past a certain point, you kind of realize, you know what? That's not my thing, because I don't like getting chased by some photographer. So if that's not your thing, great. But we have to be able to prepare her for that situation. So that's what we're trying to do.
Now, along those lines, Phil, do you have a team that you work with? Is there a certain group of people that you've kind of brought into your stable, so to speak, that you kind of work with on a daily basis with an artist like that? Or?
A lot of people I work with is based on word of mouth. So it's like if someone comes to me and asks me, do you have a vocal coach that you recommend? Then I have several. But the key part about this when you're connecting people is chemistry. Right. You'll never know until you put them together in a room and see how they react to each other. So that's the key.
Gotcha. Awesome. Down here in front, I guess I do. Yeah, you can get them right there. Yeah. Thanks.
Hi, Phil. My name is Ebenezer. I have a quick question. I just want to know, do you give opportunities for like new grads to intern with you? Like intern with you, basically?
Yes, but here's what I would recommend as far as internship. Go to a facility that does a lot of different things, because they'll expose you to a lot more, a lot of different areas in the business. If you come to me, our operation is really simple. It's just me and my assistant, that's it. So you're not gonna learn that much, you know what I'm saying? So you go to a bigger facility, they might have two or three different rooms going at the same time. different types of clients, different types of music, different situations. It'll be a better education for you.
One more question. What is the sample rate and bit depth for this particular song?
What is that? I'm sorry?
The sample rate and bit depth. All right, thank you.
Right. Do you want somebody to get the one hand in the back there? There's a couple back there.
Hey, Phil. Good
afternoon. Is this helpful? Or, okay. Okay. So, thank you.
So. Good afternoon, Phil. I'm
good
Ashwin, doing the recording arts program.
Okay.
I just wanted to ask how much of, there are like three questions, so this might be long, so I'm sorry if I take up anybody's time. But how much of, do you have connection with the mastering engineer after your mix goes out, and how much does the mastering engineer influence your mix? Like how is it changed, or is the core personality?
Right, yeah, I do have, I try to keep an open like dialogue with the mastering engineers that I work with. Sometimes it's not within my control. The label or a specific client may have their own favorites. Excuse me. So sometimes the guys that master the stuff I work on isn't the people I would pick, but that's okay. So what I do is I try to make things as easy on them as possible. If they need anything changed, they can always call me and I'll be happy to accommodate. So the mastering can absolutely kill your mix. I can't tell you how many times I've heard something and go, wow, he just completely destroyed it. But that's okay. I mean, you know, what I do is just one part of the process. So
thank you. The second question was, I see you using a lot of stock plugins, actually, which is really, really interesting. Mm-hmm. What I've experienced with plugins is when you do stuff in the box, the stereo field for your final output is really closed. Mm-hmm. And using an analog output device really opens up the stereo field at the end.
Yes.
And I know you mentioned the analog thing that you use, but if you can be specific about that and how much does it?
Okay, I have an SSL summing unit, and I have a passive summing unit. So the passive summing unit is great in the sense that you can, well, because it's what it means is that there's no power going through it. So you need to have a mic preamp to be able to crank up the level. In that situation, you can the sound of the preamp is what basically determines how what kind of character you can introduce to the mix. So that's helpful because sometimes you might use one and go, that's a little bit too much of coloring that I would prefer, and you can try a different one and tone it down a little bit, or if it's not enough, you can use something more. So again, different songs, it's going to require you to treat things or approach things differently. So if I would say that's the way to go.
And the final question is, if I'm not wrong, you did mix Bieber's last acoustic album? I'm not sure.
I did three songs, I think.
Okay. How did you approach the acoustic mix? Because these mixes are loud and they're pretty much master level quality. The one that I just heard was amazing. Mm-hmm. So how do you treat acoustic mixes and what is different? Like, how do you go about for that?
In all honesty, acoustic mixes are a pain because there's nowhere to hide things. Okay, so with this, for example, I mean, not that this was that complicated, but there's a lot more stuff going on. So if there's something that isn't quite right, you can kind of hide it. With acoustic stuff, you know, it's Justin's case, it's either a guitar in his voice or a piano in his voice, so you can't hide anything. So it's very painstaking. Everything every syllable, every note has to be, you know, massaged, so to speak. So.
Was it the same chain? Like, was it the same in the box chain or?
No, I can't imagine it. I don't even do things. I don't really do things the same way from like all the time. It just kind of depends on what the song is, what the song needs. So what the song, what I think the song needs is what determines what choices I make.
I feel like another one back here in the back row.
Okay.
Hi, I just have a question. When you approach a different artist and it has already a certain characteristic, like you said Rihanna's voice, it already has a certain characteristic that you use a certain plugin on. How do you go about that? Do they tell you, we want this type of device or we want this type of sound? Or do you just listen to the artist and say, we want this or I want this for his final sound?
Yeah, no, not trying to avoid your question, but it is, everything is a case-by-case basis. So I've been fortunate to work with on her song since 04, I think. So I'm somewhat familiar with her. So it's just a matter of how, and I can almost guarantee you what I did on this song with that particular chain, so to speak, is not the same as what I did for another song on the album. It's just, I don't know why, but it never works that way. I'm just not. If you use the same kind of setup, so to speak, and you apply it to another vocal, even if it's the same artist, but if it's a different song, it's gonna sound completely different. So again, you have to kind of be open to allowing it to tell you what it needs. I hope that makes sense.
Another question over here on the right, just right behind you there.
How you doing, Phil?
Great, thanks.
All right, my question is, everybody has their story, and I really do appreciate how you consider yourself not to be successful, but what do you consider was your lowest point in your career, and how did you get past it?
Lowest point in my career was when I started a company back in 19... I wanted to do it. I've always been kind of partial towards artists. And I always try to want to be able to be helpful to them. So I started a development company back in 98, I want to say. The problem with that situation was that my business partners were not... They weren't music people. They were people that wanted to be in the music business. And I should have never done that. And that was when, basically, I lost everything. So that would be the lowest point. So that's another business, you know, thing to tell you, to never put in your own money. So, but I made that mistake, so.
Hi, my name is Jamie.
Hello.
It's an honor to have you here.
Thank you.
I want to ask you, what was your most influential turning point as a student here at Full Sail?
As a student, I don't know if there was a specific turning point. I think the thing I remember most about being here was the instructors. And I never ever felt like they were, my teachers. I always felt like they were my friends. So I always felt comfortable going to them and say, hey, here's what I'm thinking and doing on my project. What do you think? And I could always be sure that they would give me a honest answer. So that was really the thing I valued the most was the instructors here.
Awesome. A couple of more. There's another one far back again, right?
Way back.
Sorry.
How's it going, Phil?
Good, thanks.
Cool. I got a specific question. Mostly, when I try to do a lot of mixing, I generally have a big problem with bass especially since I do like a lot of hip hop, a lot of urban kind of genres. Mm-hmm. And so my question to you is, what tips or what advice would you give me to mix like the bass line and the bass kick to make it sound large, but without having to compromise the entire mix and make it sound distorted?
I think the first thing is gonna be the sound. Okay, if you pick your sounds right, you'll be able to. That's the most important thing. A lot of really good producers that I know, Dr. Dre, for example, he would spend days just looking for the right kick drum to fit that one song. So finding, kind of tailoring your sound is going to be a big part of it. Two, I think you're going to need to, you got to get your hands dirty and experiment.
Yeah.
So there's unfortunately no magic plug-in or button that can tell you, because every song is going to be different. There's times where I might do something that does quite well out there, and a client will call and say, "Hey, you mixed this. Can you make my record sound like that?" And the answer usually is no, because your song is not made up like that song. Yeah. It's a different key. The compositionally is different, arrangement is different, the tempo is different. That all contributes to how it makes sounds. So, you know, again, not to be vague or whatever, you just have to try to make sure you keep up with all the stuff that's available. So if you hear, if you read in the trades that there's a new plugin that comes out that claims it can, you know, magically make your bass sit in the mix, try it out. Get a demo for it. And if it really does help, then maybe you can, that becomes incorporated into your workflow.
Is there any plugin that you use, like generally, like off the
top? No, the plugin I use most of the time for bass is this one here. It's the channel strip. This was one of the first plugins that tried to emulate a SSL. So in the early days, when DSP was kind of at a premium, computers weren't as powerful, having a channel strip plugin was helpful to be able to have everything in the same place versus, you know, one compressor, one EQ, and another limiter or something like that. So that's why, and in the early days when I had the first system, this was what I used, so it's always been in my, I'm used to the way it sounds, I guess.
Yeah, cool. So. Just quick, that's a Halo metric? Or?
Metric Halo channel strip, yes.
Metric Halo. Okay. Cool. Appreciate that, man.
No problem.
Awesome. Let's get this guy down here in the middle. His hand's been up for a while, and it's hard to see sometimes. So let's let him ask a question.
How you doing, Phil?
Good,
thank you for coming up. My name's Derek Stewart, and I was just kind of piggybacking off of one of the questions from earlier, because you kind of got distracted on it, as far as the studios that you would kind of recommend checking out in Atlanta. Oh. I'm from Georgia myself, and then okay. I got one more question after that.
There's not that many studios anymore in Atlanta, sadly. So if you can get, I would say expand your horizons beyond just Atlanta if it's possible. There's, but if Doppler is one of them, Tree Sound is one of them, Patchwork is another, Crawford is another studio, but again, they mainly focus on posts, not that much music.
So when they do posts, are they working for like CNN and some of the other stations there?
Exactly.
Okay, because posts are something I'm looking at going into. As far as your workflow, because you touched on like efficiency and just time is an important issue as far as getting through these mixes because you do so much. Do you have like a certain workflow as far as setting up your session to help you like get through it as quick as possible?
Yes, I kind of have a basic template that I, so for example, when this session came in, all the routing, my assistant, she's my traffic controller, basically. She, all the stuff that comes in, the communication, the file transfers coming in, going out. she'll take a look at all the stuff, make sure that the stuff is there, is supposed to be there, and the stuff that's not there, we go and get. And she sets it up for me based on the template that I have. And then go from there. So there's no, that's as far as routing. So for example, when I sit down, these effects returns, for example, would already be in the session in front of me. So, and there's usually a lot more of them, but I would just disable, make them inactive as the ones that I'm not gonna be using. So what might happen in, this didn't happen, but the piano, for example, would have been routed to a specific bus. But in this case, I decided not to use it. Just left it the way it was, because it wasn't necessary, so.
Okay. Do you use, like, subgroups?
Yes.
So you'd your instruments down and use that more or less for, like, some of the effects? I noticed how on some of those you put effects directly onto the tracks.
Yes. Some of it, because the effects are going to be slightly different depending on the instrument. So this one here and that one there is different, like in terms of how much of it. So one example would be like the amount of the reverb here is 41% of the mix versus this one here at 67, that kind of stuff. So if I had just the same, you know, just the one, when I have effects specifically on a track, it's because I want to tailor it to that specific track. So if it's like a general thing, I'm just going to put a little, you know, spring reverb on a guitar track, then yeah, it's going to come down from in the effects return tracks below.
And one over here, up in the back.
Hi, Phil. I was wondering, what is your opinion on auto-tune in today's music?
I'm not a fan of autotune, personally, but unfortunately, that's just kind of become part of our culture of pop music, I guess you can call it that. But the way I look at it is, if you're using it as an effect, that's one thing. But I think it's overdone, so I'm tired of it.
There's another one back here in the back row, I think, on this side. Yeah. Just a little further down, yep.
Hi, Phil, I'm Eric. I'm in the Recording Arts Program. And I had a couple questions for you regarding, one question actually. It was with, you brought up a lot of interesting points about kind of like mindfulness and staying grounded. And a lot of emerging artists don't kind of have perspective on their own music or their own product, if you will. And for you, we've been kind of using success kind of loosely, that term. But like with, like, for example, like Rihanna Diamonds, that's a very major release and has met a lot of success. For you personally, would you credit you getting the opportunity to mix this track? Would you credit that more to your mixing abilities or more to your own ability to stay grounded and to be able to adapt through the years? And ultimately, that's brought you that success, but gratification you've had.
See, like I said before, I'm only one part of that process, of this entire process. There were four songwriters, I think, on this song. The producers, Benny, and another writer. And then the recording engineer had to do his or her part to get the tracks recorded properly. She had to perform. Then I do my part, mastering guy does his job. Then after we're done with that side of things, it goes to record label. The radio department has to do this job. The marketing department has to do their job. It's a lot of people just for this one record. So what we do at our end is just to make sure that they have something that they can use to successfully promote and market. I cannot take any credit on that part of it. So it just, you know, I'll do my job to the best of my ability. That's all I can do. So,
I appreciate it. I guess then to find yourself in said position, do you find that, do you think that the grindfulness, or the ground, mindfulness, excuse me, mindfulness and being grounded got you to this position and being able to? Do you think having those people skills, I guess, with emerging artists?
Okay, Stargate and I started working together probably when Neo's first album came out, around that time. Okay, so we've been working on a lot of stuff over the years. It's a relationship that's solid, I guess you could say. There's no, you know, they're top-notch professionals. They do what they're gonna do when they do, when they do what they say they're gonna do when they do it. All that kind of stuff. But it's very, very professional people. So it's an easy, so I think it's one of those things that I can count on them and they can kind of count on me. So a lot of what you're gonna find in this industry is that, how reliable are you gonna be? Can you deliver when, you know, things need to be delivered? So.
Awesome, we are so grateful for having Phil with us today. Did everybody have a lot of good time and good information? Yeah.